I now want to introduce our first featured speaker. Laura Hill is here to help us better understand neurobiology of eating disorders, and she chose this title to her talk: The New Dance of Temperament-Based Therapy with Supports. I want to welcome you to our stage.
It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm going to begin by needing some support, and I'm going to ask Cecily and Mum to come on up and help me out, please. Cecily and Mum are here to help me as we begin to talk about a new therapy that I've been working to develop with the eating disorder program at UC San Diego. And between that facility and the Center for Balanced Living, we've been developing this treatment over the last 8 years. So let's just begin with some string. And what I'm going to do is ask you to hold it and maybe put your hands like this, Cecily. And Mum, if you don't mind, if you could start wrapping it around, kind of like what you do when you're unwinding a spool of yarn. And I'll bring this over. Okay, and if we run out, I have more. And I just want you to wind that string around and around. And we're going to start by, Cecily, I'm going to ask you, what would you say a habit is? How would you define a habit?
I suppose a practice that you do, but you don't think about it.
Practice you do and you don't think about it. Anybody else? How would you? I think that's probably the best and the simplest, but let's just build a couple other ideas. Anyone want to add to that? A habit. Something you do often. It might be something you like to do or something you don't like to do. So, Mom, as you're starting this, how comfortable? Is it easy? Is it difficult? Or is it just okay in trying to wind this around Cecily's hands?
It's ever so slightly awkward because this is a scratchy string.
I'm glad it's scratchy string, but it's ever so awkward to get started. And as we're talking about habits, and it's something that you just tend to not think about, and it just starts happening over and over. Now I'm going to ask, how would you define, Cecily, a ritual?
I suppose there's a bit more intention.
Keep winding.
A bit more intention to a ritual.
A bit more intention to the ritual, and as a ritual, like it may be a habit that starts into an action that then becomes something that you do every time you're in that situation.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone else? What else would you think of when you think ritual? Has a requirement to it. It's structured. It's structured with a requirement. And it has a compulsiveness to it and perhaps obsession. For example, if you're Catholic and you come into the church, it becomes a ritual to make the cross. And it's a slight compulsion, hopefully not a negative compulsion, but it's a compulsion nevertheless. And it may have a purpose. All of this is excellent. I couldn't have written this better myself. And while you are sharing this and we're thinking about this, this action is continuing to go on. So, Mom, would you say that this right now is still a little awkward, or is it getting a little easier?
I'm really into it now. I'm never going to stop.
Okay. So now she's really into it right now. And so while you're into it, I'm just going to ask you, if you're thinking of friends that may have an eating disorder, Cicely, or if you think of someone, if you could think of one eating disorder behavior that you know of, what could you name one?
I guess exercise, like
excessive. Excessive exercise. And what I would like you to think of right now is keep winding. The reality is I'd like everyone to be thinking about these this winding that's going on that I've asked Mom to never stop wiring, because I'd like you to think about this wiring as what the brain does as it's constantly functioning. And while the brain can think about other things, define concepts, work toward work on other tasks, it never ceases from firing unless it is no longer firing at all. The brain will fire to its very end, even if it's down to the simplest action. Now, this simple action that is being wired and has gotten quite easy, and she's into it, has become excessive exercise. And she is wiring in excessive exercise. And she's been wiring this excessive exercise that at first just became a simple habit of maybe when Cicely was, or I'm just going to make this up because I don't expect this to be you, but it could be another person. But let's say when she got stressed after school, she started exercise. If she ate, she started excessive exercise. So then it became the habit, and then it became the ritual. That became the compulsion, and it became ritualized in, so that the brain is now so wired. In 5 minutes, can you see the bundle that we have? Can you imagine how well the brain has wired this in 5 months? In 5 years, that the brain would by default go to its response of excessive exercise, or it may be self-induced vomiting, or it may be absolute avoidance of food or certain foods. But it becomes a ritual that becomes compulsive, becomes steadfast, becomes the method, and as Cicely said, I don't have to think about it anymore. I simply do it. Now, that's very important according to the brain. Simply do it. Just as Mum is simply doing this right now. The brain organizes itself through movement. Through movement. It starts at the lower part of the brain. Movement is involved in the middle of the brain that gets quite refined, and movement actually is wired to surround the brain. Every thought, every emotion is connected to movement. So when we're trying to adjust thoughts and emotions and actions, we have to begin, and potentially in the middle, and at the end, involve movement. Now, we therapists, researchers, and treatment providers know all the answers, of course. And since the illness became identified in 1980, we have decided, since it has, we defined it as a social psychological illness, that movement should stay out of it. And now, thanks to Dr. Walter Kay at UC San Diego and Christina Waringa's research leading the globe and now other research sites in multiple countries, we now have the opportunity to realize what's going on in the brain and how this illness of eating disorders begins, moves, and we're going to tie this up, just tie it together, and we're going to keep going. Because the illness doesn't stop. Yep, that's a good idea, Mom. Just keep it going. And now we are realizing that this illness is brain-based, and that we now that we are beginning, and I mean just beginning, to understand what's going on in the brain, and comparing that to those who have healthy brains, we can see what is overfiring, what is underfiring, we can see where. And then in the last 10 years, I've been working with them to try to find ways in treatment that we can both express what's going on, such as, would you say this is a well-ritualized excessive exercise? And notice that excessive exercise doesn't take much thought. It's just running. It's simple action. And so now, while you continue to wire, because the brain won't stop it until you redirect it. So if you want to think, let's say, after this day, and you were going to go home and have something to eat, but instead of excessively exercising after dinner, you did one other simple movement or action, what could, might that be?
Oh, I can't think of anything right now.
Mom, do you have, anybody have any? Well, let's just start with Mom.
Okay, sorry. I was...
You were concentrating on... You were being the perfect putamen in the brain, doing... Yes, you're in a trance. That's perfect. So just think, if you weren't exercising tonight, what might you be doing? Homework?
Yeah,
could you be doing homework? Could you be doing a walk with your mom? Could you be calling a friend or texting them? Choose any of the three.
So, yeah, spend time with a friend.
Spend time with a friend. So I'd like you, could you identify, I'd like you to identify a male friend because I already chose somebody.
Just anyone?
Anyone.
A name?
Just say a name.
Okay, Brad.
Brad, by way of Alec, would you be willing to come up? Where's Alec? Is he out there? Ah,
yeah.
He's going to come up and help us in this rewiring. And Brad, Alec, but Brad, you're
Brad.
And you're going to be the friend. And I'll have you stand close. And what might you be doing? You've just finished dinner, and if you were going to do something with Brad, would it be talking on the phone, texting, or walking, or what would you prefer?
Talking on the phone.
So what you're now going to do, Mom, is I'd like you to put your hand out, Alec, and you're going to wire Alec in by starting to chat. And I'm going to stand here, and I want you to just go ahead and I'm dialing Brad,
mm-hmm.
I'm not dialing him, I'm just text him, or just put him in, and I fast forward, go to Brad, and then just start a conversation. And as long as you're talking and Brad is talking, you get to wire in a new way.
Mm-hmm.
But if you stop, you might start running, and I want you to then rewire back into the default. So you have to direct the conversation, or you have to direct the action going, I'm talking to Brad now, even though I don't know what to say because all these people are watching me. But but I'm talking to Brad, because if you aren't making yourself talk to Brad, you're going to then go back to default.
Okay.
Fair enough?
Okay. Hello, Brad. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Also great.
Just go. Just talk.
Okay. Have you watched the most recent episode of Arrested Development?
Oh yeah, I love that show.
Yeah, I don't know. The last season wasn't great.
Yeah, the last season definitely didn't meet up to the expectations of the previous seasons. I'd agree with that.
Yeah.
Okay, now we can stop for a minute. So, would you say that in talking to Brad, you've got a simple, new one-step alternative to the default?
Yeah, definitely.
And would you? What did it take to get this default to go there?
Talking to Brad.
And so you had to intentionally mm-hmm. force yourself to go there.
Mm-hmm.
And if not Brad, and you decided, well, tomorrow night it's not going to be Brad, but it's going to be maybe a walk with Mom. So then you begin to wire to Mom, and both of you do this together and walk maybe for 20 minutes after the thing. So let's say you talk to Brad one night, walk with Mom one night. You've got a few wires here and a few wires here. go ahead and wire yourself in for a minute as if she's, you, yep, you just wire yourself in. And you just, yep, that's exactly how complicated, when you include other people, it gets very complicated, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And that's why many people with eating disorders don't like to include other people. It's just too complicated when I can do it all myself. And I've got it all worked out, and I feel better, actually. I don't feel as good talking to Brad as I do when I run, but I'm intentionally trying to make that work right now. Mm-hmm. And how many wires is competing with this wire? How long do you think it would take talking to Brad to finally compete with this bundle?
About the same length of time as you've been running, doing
so
exercise.
It may take months.
Yeah.
You willing, Brad, to hang in on the phone?
Sure.
And so it may...
Unlimited text and yeah. call time.
So Brad is offering support as long as you initiate it to try for months to be able to counter this. And if mom is helping, and it may, you say, Brad one night, mom the other night, that we've got half of the bundle here, half of it there, and twice here. So you can do different activities, but every different activity is going to result in less wiring to compete with the one activity you've been doing for as the basis. Is everyone seeing that? The bottom line of this is, we've worked way too hard to make it too complicated. And the simpler you make it as support people, in the simple thing of planning ahead, if after the meal tonight it's going to be hard, tell me one thing you want yourself to do, and then she may say, just go and text my friend. Then let her help clean up after the dinner, and then the fact being she goes and talks, and Brad is brought into the conversation saying, you're helping distract. She may be a little irritable in her mood, and the fact is she's trying to intentionally rewire her brain while her brain is defending the default to move. So let's say, Brad, you're thinking she may kind of de-escalate a little better if she's moving. You may even say, while we talk, even though I'm here and you're there, let's walk, but I'm going to know if you're running because I want to see you on the phone. And so you can help monitor, but you could be walking, even if it's just walking in your room back and forth. I walk with my clients in circles all the time because I feel I'm going in circles all the time. And so the fact is, we're moving if that helps. If not, maybe sitting and talking is fine. Moving with mom may be a great release, and you may say very little, but you are together and mom is helping determine the pace, not you. Because mm-hmm. clients will go, Dr. Hill, is this how fast we're going to go? Yes, we're going this slowly compared to what you're used to. And the fact is, you're rewiring, but you cannot rewire unless it's intentional. It will be painful. It will be awkward, just like you said. It's awkward at first until it becomes a habit, until it becomes a ritual. And the magic and amazing miracle of the brain is the less this wiring is used, it starts literally going backwards and kind of decaying away. It literally stops firing after a while, and this is where the action is. So simple alternatives, including some movement with that you plan ahead of time and then help carry out intentionally, is how the brain begins to move away from the destructive symptoms. Okay? So what is, just walk away from this and leave it behind in every sense of the word. Thank you very much. Where's that clicker? I'll just. Okay. So we just did wire, rewire, and now with a few words, but these are the tenets of temperament-based treatment or therapy with support. And what we just named this a year ago. Now let's put this in perspective. How many people know what diabetes is? It's an illness that involves what organ? the pancreas. What does the pancreas make?
Insulin.
Insulin. Why do you need insulin? Why does the body need insulin? So what? It makes insulin. It adjusts blood sugar. So I would like you to think of insulin as the sense of it's the partner to every bit of glucose or energy that you eat. So here's insulin partnering up with every molecule of energy that is coming into the body. And so the energy and with the insulin beside it is going down the blood vessels, heading towards various cells to keep the cells in your body alive. And it is only the insulin that unlocks the cell door to let the energy in so that the cell can live out its purpose and continue to express itself. Without insulin, the food just moves right on through the body and eventually it's peed out. As long as humankind has existed, diabetes has existed. There have been some people who genetically became vulnerable and developed diabetes as a child, and those children died for hundreds and thousands of years. They called it actually the illness of sweet pea because the urine was so filled with glucose. It wasn't, ironically, thousands of years of losing children to diabetes. It wasn't until 1915 that technology became strong enough or powerful enough to recognize that through the anatomy and through the technology, they saw that it was the pancreas that was, in fact, not functioning to varying degrees. Now, there are those who have diabetes in a mild way, and if they follow a healthy particular diet, then that particular, they can go without taking additional insulin. There are those that may need to take an insulin pill because they monitor their food, or there are those that will need insulin forever to constantly match because they make no insulin at all. Now, if we treated diabetes the way we've been treating eating disorders, we know that the symptoms of diabetes are you lose a huge amount of weight because no energy is going into the cells. The person is highly irritable because they're getting no food and nourishment. They often drink a lot of water to compensate. They're just thirsty. The body's trying to get something into itself. So if we treated diabetes this way, with the way we treat eating disorders, I would probably say you need to eat more. We're going to have you eat more food. We're going to have you drink less water, and we're going to have you go to anger management classes. Now, I ask, will that fulfill and change diabetes? No. But we've been approaching diabetes, or we've been approaching eating disorders from a direction that looks at only the thinness, that it is an issue about trying to be too thin, that I'm in control of, I am the one that made this happen, I'm the one that turned this on. And it wasn't until technology began to see into the brain, a much more complicated organ than the pancreas. And it wasn't until we started looking into the patterns of the brain that we began to realize this illness, the social pressure is secondary, if not tertiary, to what's happening in the brain and the genetic predispositions. So eating disorders is about 100 years behind the research of diabetic research. In 2015, we're beginning to look at what's happening in the brain patterns. In 2019, we're starting a treatment that's helping you understand the biology and the basis of this illness. And the interesting thing is, when in 1915 they discovered what was wrong, it took them 10 years to develop synthetic insulin, to be able to dose and to be able to manage the illness from which we've managed it forward. So we are at the place in science where in 2019, we're beginning to make the insulin. We're looking at technology that without invading the brain and also invading the brain, deep brain stimulation, which is like a hair going in. And there's a study that is going to start in Brisbane, Australia. There's been a study in England and one in Canada that's literally firing in a place where the brain is so under-functioning and under-firing in anorexia. And they're starting to see literally 50% of one of the former, one of the recent studies, the clients with anorexia got up after the stimulation started. They could turn it on, they could turn it off. And when it was turned on, they were able to make trust their decisions better, be able to trust that it was okay to eat. The brain started to shift to make up for what it was not doing, just like the pancreas began to get the help of synthetic insulin. We're now even looking at sonogram or sauna ultra light laser, and we're also looking at sound laser. And there's studies that are literally taking drugs into little baskets into the area, and then you burst the basket and let the drug only function in that area instead of having medications have such wide side effects. The point of what I'm trying to say is we are in the time with eating disorders of being able to just make the insulin. We haven't discovered the best way to do it yet. Our technology is not developed yet. We're just beginning to realize what's going on in the brain, how it's going on, and how we could then try to help adjust it. And even when we have those methods, we will always need the supports. So temperament-based therapy is the umbrella term for saying it is a temperament illness. It is the basis of genetics and the genetics and the neurochemistry, and that it cannot be done without supports. So we are saying eating disorders are brain-based. We are treating to the trait, which is the temperament. You may have temperaments of stubbornness. You may have a trait. We all have. We live and exist from our genetic profiles of what your personalities are, and we know that certain flavors of personalities set one up to become more vulnerable to anorexia or bulimia or binge eating disorder, and so these traits, instead of getting rid of them, which is what treatment has been doing, you've got to get rid of your perfectionism, you've got to get rid of your harm avoidance, you've got to get rid of only seeing errors instead of what works. We're saying you never get rid of traits. They are genetically in you. But when the trait is a good trait that's gone bad, and we therefore our job in treatment and in with help with supports is we can try to move and force and rewire the brain to start moving toward letting that trait become a trait that's productive instead of destructive. We treat food as medicine, and we literally at times dose it and say you need to eat all of it, just like an antibiotic, that movement is central to change, and that supports are necessary and must be involved even in adult treatment. And we've been researching that since 2014 and are finding positive and have published new research. So I'll sum this up by saying, let's just look at a healthy tree. And thoughts are and feelings are the basis of this tree, and the actions are what flourish from those thoughts and feelings. But then some trees have energy that is literally just diminishing from it, and the trunk begins emptying out, and the strength of it becomes weakened. And this is not unlike what happens with anorexia or those who lose weight and this terrible illness. And whatever eating disorder, what we see is those painful and difficult experiences begin to, literally the brain starts rewiring itself and the illness begins to just settle in and helps cope through all the difficulties and settles in and becomes home. And so our current eating disorder treatments, whether it's cognitive behavioral, dialectical behavioral, family-based therapy, integrative cognitive affective therapy, interpersonal therapy, acceptance and commitment therapy, and this is a treatment as usual type therapy, they all deal with thoughts. They all deal with feelings. They're all out there trying to help address this illness because they've all treated the illness as if it's all about thoughts and feelings. Mantra out of England is beginning to point the way down, but isn't doing any active treatment on the basis. But so what is missing? And what's missing is the roots. And what are the natural underpinnings of this illness that literally cause the illness to take form? We now know that the personality profile may result in a CEO or a heart surgeon. We know that people who develop, for example, anorexia are higher than average in anxiety or in intelligence, and at the same time become more potential to do amazing things. But if that illness resulted in it becoming awry or destructive for a while, how do we get those branches recognizing the roots that are feeding them and the genes that are feeding them? So we have to acknowledge what genes and traits, how those genes are addressing the brain, which is what we are researching now, and looking at the traits. And those traits are what determine where those branches are going. Society can bend the branches, but the traits make the branches. And that's why we have developed this new treatment. And so we also need, and that's not enough, we need the supports. We need all of you. Because there is no way this amazing tree and this amazing person is going to be able to grow well and grow and become its full potential without the supports helping to shape those branches. So as a result, it takes a woods to treat this, and that's the tidbit for today.
So our timing is a little, it's going to be a little interesting here. So it may not be exactly on your program, but I want to take a few moments for questions for Dr. Hill.
Hi, thank you for that presentation. I noticed that there was no mention of medication. And I think about my daughter who is trying to do those tiny actions to shift and rewire. But she's a bag of cats. You know, she's a nervous wreck. And recently was told, like, you know, maybe you need anti-anxiety medication because she can't do the thing because she's such a wreck. So where does medication fall in this?
You are right. Medication is a part of this, and it needs to be a part of this because just like we use insulin to compensate for what the pancreas does not create, we are realizing the importance of medication and to make up for the serotonergic and the dopaminergic and the epinephrine and various circuits that are misfiring. None of those medications are going to be addictive because they don't sell on the streets because nobody else wants them. But the fact is they are critical in helping shift. The frustrating thing about them, nothing yet for anorexia has been proven through random controlled trials to be the effective medication. Bulimia has one, and that's fluoxetine, and binge eating disorder has one, Vyvanse. But anorexia yet has no. Now, there are anecdotal studies looking at it, and there are certain medications they have done random controlled trials that actually found regular serotonergic uptake inhibitors are not often effective enough. They have to go to higher levels of medication, and the higher levels however, at lower doses appear to be showing impact, and they're literally starting this year a random controlled trial to test one of those. So medication is very much a part. Sometimes it's just a transitional part to lower the horrendous mental pain and anxiety that is impossible to function in. And until you've got things rewired, we had one individual, for example, who was who had had an illness, anorexia, almost died twice, inpatient twice. She was an adult. She refused to go back to inpatient. We brought family, we brought the whole treatment team together, and we said, you cannot continue without medication, and you continue to deny wanting to take it. So you have two choices. And we give multiple choice. We don't give open-ended. What do you want to do? We say there are two choices. She's an adult, but her life is in jeopardy. So you can either take medication, or you can go and have the additional support that we will all provide, or you go inpatient where they'll monitor you 24/7. Okay, if those are my options, I'll take the medication. She took it for 2 years, phased down. New habits and rituals were wired in. She's now married. She's working full time, but she constantly monitors and manages, because her illness is one that, like some, she has to think through. She didn't wire out of the illness like a younger child might, but as an older individual, she now continues to manage and monitor everything she does, but she's living a happy, healthy, and very productive life. That was a long answer.
Laura, do we have time for one more question?
Why or how behaviors just stop? First I'm going to say two things. It is behavior that actually gets us better, and then there are behaviors that are destructive. So if we use the same term, we use one term for only the destructive, we're taking away the same word that helps us get better. So we do know that as the bodies and brain start to restore itself through extra glucose and nutrition, that circuits just start altering, and the brain literally can think differently, because the more starved the brain becomes, it becomes wired, it gives up anything extra and only does what is necessary or what's become ritualized. And so when it starts getting refed, the neurons are waking up again, or refiring, or growing new circuit pathways. It can really, suddenly, something that seems so important is no longer important, because it seems, feels, and thinks better to do another thing. So it can change. Some things can happen very quickly. Other things take a lot of intention over time. I don't know if that answered it well enough, but that we do know that the body can change some behaviors over some destructive behaviors very quickly, and other ones take more time to rewire. But it's behavior that does both.
Thank you, Dr. Hill. Give a round of applause for Dr. Hill.